Welcome to the Insurgent Pedagogists. If you've heard people talking about decolonising the curriculum, liberating their degree, or heard of the Roads Must Fall movement, and wondered what it all means for you or your kids, then this is for you.
If you're wondering what a punk pedagogist is, who this Rhodes guy was anyway, or have any questions about our failing education system, then use the comments section to ask. And while you're there, remember to like and subscribe.
I'm Olorun Teleola.
I'm Nick.
And together, we are the Insurgent Pedagogists.
Welcome to the one about colonisation.
Welcome.
So this is the second time we've sat down to record one of these.
Yes, and we've thought about colonisation. We've gone backwards and forwards. We've delayed recording.
Basically, we've realised this is such a huge topic.
Yeah.
It's kind of paralysing us, and that perhaps actually the better thing to do is just to get on and record some stuff. Talk about what we're going through, what colonisation is, and then hopefully we'll be ready to move on to talk about what decolonisation is in a later episode.
Yeah, so for starters, I think it's important to talk about where this idea of colonisation, decolonisation came from, just to give some context to what has been going on within the higher education sector, particularly with regards to conversations in academia.
Okay, so the term colonisation in the context of higher education was not one that I was at all aware of until at least 2015.
Mm.
So it's only been kicking around for kind of the last 5 years.
Yeah.
And it seems to have come about through the Roads Must Fall movement, which really did begin in 2015.
Mm.
So the Roads Must Fall movement was about removing all statues and references to Cecil Rhodes. It began in South Africa. And the reason for the protest was that Cecil Rhodes was a colonialist. It was Rhodesia that was named after him. And he was also a slave trader and a racist. So students protested this and wished to have his memory erased from their campuses. And it seems to have ignited loads of interesting conversations around what decolonising the curriculum is.
Mm.
But yeah, it wasn't until at least 2016 that I was really writing about decolonisation.
Mm.
The idea of colonisation beyond discussions of empire, of statehood, of occupying another territory was something new.
Yes, it was.
And I know you, Tele, have found a definition of what traditionally we refer to as colonisation.
Yeah, so the Oxford Dictionary defines colonisation as the act of appropriating a place or domain for one's own use. So basically, what the seven European powers, which Britain, France, Germany, Belgium, Spain, Portugal and Italy, what they did during the scramble for Africa.
Okay, but we're not really talking about places anymore, are we?
No, we're not talking about places at all, but we are talking about perhaps about domain, colonisation of higher education, of legal structures, of cyberspace, for example.
Okay, and when we get into that slightly more complicated idea of what colonisation means, these are, from my experience, quite often misunderstood. People are talking at cross purposes, there are differences of opinion.
Yeah. So we talked in the first episode about the epistemological and ontological question. So the ways of knowing and the what knowing is, and that's the idea of the Enlightenment having privileged something that was essentially someone's opinion into being regarded as an irrefutable truth.
Okay, so we talked about rationality,
yeah,
being privileged over the emotional.
Yeah.
We talked about the written record, and you spoke a lot about this, being privileged over the oral tradition.
Yeah.
We talked about Eurocentric, so essentially European ideas,
yeah,
of right and just being historically reframed as human rights.
Mm.
In fact, the entire Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which lots of people think of as some kind of world view of what is right and just, is really just kind of British and, to a lesser extent, European morals written up as this formal document.
Absolutely. Another example is the fact that autonomy was elevated above relational concerns. And by that, I mean the philosophy of Immanuel Kant. Immanuel Kant was a German philosopher, so this idea of Western philosophy. And autonomy was very Western. You know, at the same time, many of the countries in the rest of the world, such as the African nations, lots of Aboriginal cultures, were developing at the same time a philosophy that was more relational, more community-based, but autonomy has essentially become the elevated principle.
Well, it's really at the core of global capitalism, isn't it?
Absolutely.
And I know you've got some views on Kant.
Yeah, Kant was definitely racist. I mean, Kant divided the human species into four different races of descending levels of ability and worth. The whites, who have all the talents and motivating forces. The Asians, who are capable of education, but not in the abstract concepts necessary for philosophy. The Africans, who can only be educated only as slaves or servants. And the Native Americans, who are not capable of education at all. Basically, in Kant's opinion, only white Europeans are capable of philosophizing.
We've got this idea of a perspective being elevated to an inalienable truth. And you've talked about the centrality given in the global north to the individual, this Kantian notion of individual liberty, which is reflected in political narratives around individual responsibility.
Yeah.
And I think it's fair to say that in the global north, we now have an underdeveloped concept of community. In English law, for example, there really is no concept of group rights. A group is a collection of individual legal entities. And that contrasts quite sharply with other communities, other cultures, where group or community rights are really at the heart of much of what they do. So the African Union recognises group rights.
Yeah.
Indigenous and First Nation societies in countries like Canada, the United States, Australia, all claim group rights.
Yeah.
And sometimes these group rights extend to both their ancestors and also their descendants yet to be born.
Absolutely. This philosophy of communalism is referred to as Ubuntu, and it's expressed in the Zulu phrase Umuntu Umuntu Gabantu, which translates as a person is a person because of other people. So I am because of who we all are.
Okay, so we've got communalism versus individualism.
Or autonomy, yes, absolutely. And this communalism is central to many cultural expressions. And one of the most renowned is the music of the South African group Ladysmith Black Mambazo. And this week, the death of their founding member, Joseph Shabalala, was announced. So here is their version of The Lion Sleeps Tonight, dedicated to his memory. May he rest in power.
A family live close to the jungle. At the end of the day, they all sit together around the fire. They have their supper, then relax and talk a little. The youngest boy becomes afraid. He hears all the sounds of the wild animals in the forest. Cheetahs, wolves, jackals and lions. He starts crying at the darkness and wild sounds that fill him with fear. Then his mother takes him in her arms and sings to him. The family is always strong together. They protect one another. Grandparents, his father and mother, uncles, aunts, cousins, brothers and sisters. They all join and sing together. Soon he falls asleep. Only the beautiful song fills his ears.
In the jungle, the mighty jungle, the lion sleeps tonight. In the jungle, the mighty jungle, the lion sleeps tonight. Hush, my baby, don't fear, my darling, the lion sleeps tonight. Hush, my baby, don't fear, my darling, the lion sleeps tonight.
That was really good. I enjoyed that, and it helped put those ideas of community kind of a bit more into context, I think.
Absolutely.
So in terms of higher education then, because that's really at the heart of what we're talking about, colonisation seems to mean taking this one set of truths, values and experiences, those truths, values and experiences that are of the coloniser, and creating structures where they're elevated to the status of universal truths.
Yeah.
So that the colonised, who have different truths, different values, different experiences, have to disregard these and adopt those of the colonizer.
Yeah, absolutely. So talking about then the manifestations of colonization in higher education, so the student's success or attainment is measured by how well they can replicate what they're told is knowledge or knowing, which is really a white, straight, middle-class male view of the world. Alternatives to this are sidelined to specialist courses like women's studies, yeah, or to optional modules where they're described as critical studies.
Definitely. Yeah. So, yeah, of course, this means that those students who aren't pale, male and stale can succeed by learning to play the white man's game.
Mm, yeah.
But for many, this manifests itself in some of the problems the higher education sector is grappling with.
Yeah.
Even the perceived winners, those who have attained educational achievement, have done so at a huge personal cost, losing or suppressing part of who they are to become something different.
So basically, adopting a working identity in order to survive and thrive. These individuals often suffer double harm, because although labelled successful by the white man, they'll never be truly regarded as equal, yet others will label them as coconut, Oreo or bounty.
And what does that mean?
It means black on the outside but white on the inside.
So for those who fail to adopt a working identity, the system will fail them.
Yeah.
And it will also blame them for this failure.
Mm.
So people of colour, we know from the statistics, are less likely to remain in higher education, less likely to progress in higher education, less likely to achieve the best outcomes at graduation.
Mm.
They're less likely to progress after study to further postgraduate study or graduate employment. And if they do all of this, they will earn on average less than their white peers.
Yeah, absolutely. This, however, is labelled as an attainment gap, blaming students of colour for lack of attainment, ignoring the failure of the education system to properly award credit to people of colour.
In fact, I think if our listeners take one thing away from this podcast, perhaps it should be that we stop talking about an attainment gap at all and start talking about an award gap.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because focusing on attainment in a language of blame is not only false but also unjust.
Mm. Yeah.
These students are not only navigating the educational domain, which is a colonised and white space, but they're also navigating their lives as young adults existing in modern Britain, which has been fairly characterised as a hostile environment.
Yeah.
So the Guardian columnist and author Afua Hirsch talks about this in her book Brit-ish, with the ish being in brackets, and highlights some of the new forms of racism that people of colour encounter more or less daily. She talks of expectations of gratitude, of microaggressions, of the language that she used, and as BAME, the Black Asian Minority Ethnic, as a tool for avoidance.
Yeah.
She talks about people being asked to speak for their own race, people who claim not to see race, and people using phrases like political correctness gone mad.
Yeah.
So how does all of this manifest itself in identity?
There are differences between the ideals, values and expectations on first and second generation immigrants, and by extension, the effect these ideals have on their identity. I'm a first generation immigrant who came to the UK about 13 years ago from Nigeria to get a degree in order to better myself, and also more importantly, my family in Nigeria. I'm now married with kids, but that goal of bettering myself and the expectation to look after my family in Nigeria hasn't changed. Growing up in Nigeria, there were ideals, values and expectations that formed the basis of my identity. One example was the implied expectation that I had to get the best grades possible in order to get the best job available so that I could give back to the community I came from. And most importantly, like I said, take really good care of my family. Now, this is the bubble within which myself and most first-generation immigrants exist.
Okay.
Now, our children are second-generation immigrants.
And most of my students will either be second, third, or maybe even 20th generation immigrants.
Absolutely. They are born and raised here. Some may have been raised on the ideals of their first-generation parents and grandparents. The difference is that they live in a different society and may therefore not relate to the importance of those ideals. So although they feel a sense of loyalty to those first generation roots, their sense of belonging naturally gravitates towards this society.
Because they were born here and essentially Britain is all they really know.
Absolutely. However, this society is one steeped in institutional legacies of oppression and slavery towards people who look like them. And because these legacies have not been properly acknowledged and addressed, their identity within this society is in limbo. They experience some form of societal rejection from the time they're born to the time they die, in the workplace where they're passed off for promotions and by the police force, even in schools where they're told that their hairs shouldn't be worn in a certain way.
So in order to prove themselves then, they have to work twice as hard as their white counterparts, and even then there's no guarantee of acceptance.
Absolutely. And in future episodes we can discuss how some of these issues can be addressed.
Excellent. I look forward to that. Thank you.
You're very welcome.
We've been the Insurgent Pedagogists. Thanks for tuning in.
No one's tuned in. We're not on the wireless.
Okay, but if our listener has any questions, she can write them on a postcard and send them in to us.
No, we'd love to hear people's questions, but they can just post them in the comment section below. And while they're there, they can like and subscribe too.
And if you want to know more about us, we're on the interweb at wordpress.com/insurgentpedagogy.
Spot on. We've been Teleola and Nick. The music was from www.bensound.com.